Hello, I'm Dr. Connie Webster of the Department of Nursing and Health Professions at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome to Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. Our topic for today is identifying and treating mental health problems. And my guest is Dr. William Lawson. Dr. Lawson is currently professor and chairman of the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Howard University College of Medicine and Hospital. He is also a professor on the graduate faculties of psychology and pharmacology. He received his bachelor's degree from Howard University, a master's from the University of Virginia, and PhD in psychology from the University of New Hampshire. He received his MD from the University of Chicago. He is certified by the Board of Psychiatry and Neurology in General Psychiatry and has added qualifications in addictions. He is the immediate past president of the Washington Psychiatric Society and the Black Psychiatrist of America. In addition, he is a distinguished fellow of the American Psychiatric Association and a member of the American College of Psychiatrists and the recipient of many distinguished awards associated with his outstanding work. Dr. Lawson has conducted numerous clinical trials to new treatments, and through his research grants, he has been afforded the opportunity to realize his dream of studying the interaction of culture and genetics in ethnicity and mood disorders. He has over 100 publications involving severe mental illness and its relationship to psychopharmacology, substance abuse, and racial and ethnic issues. Dr. Lawson has a long-standing concern for ethnic disparities in mental health treatment, and he has been an outspoken advocate for access to services for the severely mentally ill. Dr. Lawson, welcome to Health Matters.
Thank you for inviting me. I really appreciate it.
I appreciate having you here. And anything that we can say today, I'm sure, will be a timely topic as we're looking at mental health, not only in the community of the District of Columbia, but from a national perspective. And I need not tell you about all of the notoriety for some of the gun control issues and some of the mass murders that in the end, people are saying resulted from persons who had mental disorders. I am sure you will say, and I will certainly go on record saying, that not all mental illness ends up in such catastrophic manners, and that is why we're here to talk about identifying and getting appropriate treatment. For starters, I'm going to ask you to just share with our viewers the kinds of things that are diagnoses that you are seeing regularly here as you're treating our citizens here in the District of Columbia.
Well, first of all, I want to note that mental disorders themselves are not a source of violence per se. If you look at people with mental disorders, they are no more risky of committing violence or other acts than the general population.
Okay.
When they are under treatment.
When they're under treatment.
Right. So one thing they have right is that all of this notoriety and attention mm-hmm. is at least has shown that people with mental disorders are not getting the treatment they're needed, and that's the most important part.
Absolutely, and I think for our program today, that is why this topic is very critical. Being able to identify, get the person into treatment so they can have some quality of life and remain contributing citizens of the of our cities and of our states. So for family members or even for individuals who might have concerns about, well, if I say my person or myself or my family member is mentally ill, they'll lock us up and put us away. Could you kind of help with distorting that notion?
Because we recognize mental disorders, like general medical conditions, can vary all the way from very severe to very mild.
Right.
There are some mental disorders that are quite common. One of the most common ones is major depression.
Right.
We often do not give as much attention to depression because it's so common, because we think it's a normal condition,
mm-hmm.
And we recognize that it's very different from another very severe disorder such as schizophrenia,
right.
when people get out of touch with reality.
Right.
A lot of the attention in terms of violence has been focused on those people that have psychosis that are out of touch with reality. But we must remember that many of these acts of violence are also done by people who are depressed.
That is true.
And this kind of major depression is one that we should also recognize, not only because it is a source of potential violence, but many of these folks are at great risk for killing themselves. We think about the concerns about the victims, but we must also recognize that mental disorders are a great source of personal distress and problems.
Right.
The African-American community for a long time was thought not to get disorders such as depression, or that it was very uncommon.
Right.
When in fact we find that it is quite common.
Mm-hmm.
We sometimes misdiagnose these individuals, say they have a psychosis and they end up hospitalized, and discourage people from coming forth when they have problems of major depression or others.
You bring up a great point about discouraging individuals from seeking psychiatric counseling at any level. If I had a diabetic problem or a cardiac problem, right away people would tell me that I need to see a specialist in that discipline. But for some reason, there is this stigmatization about persons seeing psychiatrists. And you don't have to wait till you have depression or anything else to get counseling. I know some people do it as a way of clearing the air and doing prevention for the kinds of anxieties and frustrations that we have. So I think that that's a very important point that you make. How is it, and I know that if you are working and your advocacy has been in trying to get treatment for patients with psychiatric disorders, how is it that we deal with the society to have them understand and accept that going for help and counseling equates to the same thing as doing prevention with diabetes and any other kinds of diseases that you're trying to stay in equilibrium with?
I think you said it very, very nicely. And that is, we try to go to health fairs and other opportunities where discussions of health problems and try to help people to recognize that you should also seek help if you have persisting problems with depression, persisting problems with anxiety. Post-traumatic stress disorder
Absolutely.
Is not just a problem in combat.
Right.
We find that it's extremely common in many inner city areas.
Right.
As well as problems with tentative psychosis.
Right. And when I think about all of the adolescent violence, things that are happening to young men and people getting shot up in the presence of others, I would think that that also would start this pre-post-traumatic stress kind of thinking about why it happened to some people and not others, or the what ifs, or could I have done something better. Do you think our children are more prone now to even the depression and the PTSD kinds of things that than we would have been in a more protected society?
I think we're certainly recognizing it more.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an interesting contrast. On one hand, we recognize it more, we recognize the impact, but on the other hand, many of us are much more likely, as you mentioned, because of the stigma, to deny when
right.
we have these problems.
Right.
Especially our young men.
Right.
Rather than going out and seeking help or talking about these problems, they may act it out and beget more of the problems than we had before.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important and extremely crucial that we help our young people to recognize that when they are in distress, that sometimes the parents and others, we would like them to go to the parents, we'd like them to go to our support systems first, but sometimes they may need professional help.
Mm-hmm.
And the professions should be recognized that they should work with the community to be sure that we can have early interventions that lead to keeping people in the community and also helping them to function.
Right, because right now, even though in my opening remarks I stated that many people will not either take themselves or family members to a psychiatric consultation because they're in fear that they would be locked up. But the truth of the matter is, in today's psychiatric medicine, we're treating in the least restrictive environment, so it is not the desire to lock people up.
And yet, that's exactly what's happening. The U.S. has shown a 300% increase mm-hmm. in terms of people that are incarcerated in the past 30 years.
Right.
And it's for two reasons. One right. is we made an effort to stop locking up the mentally ill in hospitals, but what happens if people show unusual behavior, especially African Americans, is they're more apt to be arrested and incarcerated anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And people who have substance abuse problems, we said getting the drug dealers off the street. But what we've done is put a lot of nonviolent offenders in the correctional system.
Right.
So at least for African Americans, there's a high risk if you show behavior that is unacceptable or unusual to end up locked up, not necessarily in a mental health facility, but in the correctional system.
Right.
Even though they many times are the same individuals, and even though we now have the technology to be able to treat people effectively without having them being locked up by various forms of advanced psychotherapy, sometimes medication, and other techniques.
Mm-hmm.
We can keep people from being put away, as they said in the old days,
right.
and have people remain effective and productive in the community
right.
if we can get early intervention. And if the people that they contact with, the family members, the correctional system, and others are aware that there are alternatives to putting people away.
Right, and I know that there's a great deal of denial on the individual's part as well as on family members. And it might be even hard to do this, but I'm gonna ask anyway, as a concerned person, a mother and a grandmother, and even working with youth ministries, are there some clear signs that individuals may display that would say this person is really having a difficult time and needs to seek some psychiatric assistance?
Many times we recognize that there is something going on.
Mm-hmm.
The person begins to withdraw, they show problems in their job,
right.
they show problems in terms of school, and not just that they have problems temporarily, but they are persisting. For depression,
okay.
for example, if a person starts having symptoms for most of the day, for over 2 weeks, we start thinking of major depression.
Right.
If a person starts acting in a bizarre way, out of touch reality, you think about drug abuse, or you might think about, they may have a psychotic episode.
Right.
So many times we recognize that people are acting unusual. Sometimes we want to let them have their own way and see what happens. But many times folks will come up, especially folks who end up killing themselves, they will tell their friends or families, and sometimes even the providers, look, I don't think life is worth living, and I don't see any alternatives.
Right.
And when we hear that, we really need to be aware that the person isn't just playing around, that the person needs to have some sort of intervention. On our campuses, we find that this has become an emerging problem.
Right.
And young people are especially at risk on our campuses. On one hand, we've done a good job in helping people to cope and to deal with life when they have mental problems.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, many folks end up in school doing well, but at the same time still struggling with these issues.
Right. You also brought up in your conversation the notion of substance abuse. And many patients with psychiatric disorders also have what we call dual diagnosis, a substance abuse diagnosis as well. And for a long time, there was the question of what came first, the chicken or the egg. If the individual was doing the substance to medicate and help with the psychiatric disorder, or was the psychiatric disorder the root cause of the substance abuse? Do you have a position?
Yeah, that it probably doesn't make a heck of a lot of difference.
But I'd like to hear
it. Yeah, the age of, no, that it doesn't matter which came first.
Mm-hmm.
The age of onset of both of these conditions tremendously overlap.
So it's the age of onset?
The same for substance abuse and mental disorders.
Right.
And what we find is that substance abuse, if it occurs, can hasten early onset of mental disorders, and we find that mental disorders can lead to substance abuse. So some people use drugs of abuse to feel good, just for thrill and excitement, but many other people also use them as coping strategies to see if they can deal with some of the anxiety, depression, or unusual feelings they have, and as a result, they may become hooked and end up with having both problems occurring together. Mm-hmm. So both of them occur together, and in recognition of that, we often promote what we call dual diagnosis or comorbidities.
Mm-hmm.
The Department of Mental Health in the District of Columbia has recognized this, and will be moving to integrate its substance abuse services as well as mental health services in terms of a behavioral health program, something that many other states have done, often to good effect. Because it often doesn't make sense to try to tease out which is which.
Mm-hmm.
You really have to treat them both if they occur together.
And when you were talking about PTSD, and you said it was not strictly associated with war-related injuries, I would like to just talk a little bit about, indeed, those persons who are returning. Many of our young vets returning with war-related diseases, and even talk about the rate of suicides that have been attributed to these stints of service. What are your thoughts about our ability to receive and adequately treat them and provide the appropriate counseling for their families so that they can reintegrate into communities?
Well, I think the good news is that if we recognize these problems and had the will to treat them, we can. Often because of the requirements and combat situations. And also the culture of the military service tend to discount mental disorders, and we tend to try to encourage the person to be able to function despite having mental symptoms. So as a result, folks may have persisting symptoms for a long time, do not come to the attention and get the treatment that's needed in the service until they're actually discharged, even though the service has done a pretty good job of making sure there is treatment available. So we're putting a lot of resources now, a little thing belatedly, to recognize that when folks are discharged from active duty, the stresses and problems that they incurred are still very much present.
Absolutely.
They take it out into the larger society, and often they do not, often cannot access treatment.
Right.
The Veterans Administration has been doing a great job in the past in terms of making itself available. There's been a change in terms of the philosophy of delivering services in terms from the Veterans Administration. There's much more of an encouragement of folks to seek services from other kinds of healthcare delivery systems unless the event is clearly directly related to participating in the service.
Right.
Nevertheless, the result is that they recognize that there is a problem, that the resources need to be done. They are now going to be adding something like 30,000 additional mental health providers to address the concern.
Right. Right.
But at the same time, many of these folks have already struggled for years to address this issue.
Right.
I'm a very active member of the Congressional Black Caucus Veterans Brain Trust.
We've
been very, very actively involved in helping to try to get benefits so these individuals can get the treatments. African Americans are less likely to get VA benefits than others, and at the same time, we're more likely to suffer
to
from PTSD
right.
and other conditions.
Right.
So clearly, there's a recognition there's a problem, but we've got to do more, especially to address the needs of the African American veteran.
Right.
Who end up much more likely to be unemployed or homeless, despite various kinds of veteran preferences and other opportunities.
And you mentioned homelessness. Many of our homeless residents have some level of psychiatric disorders. And I don't know how our communities are, number one, able to track them, and then the second thing, provide appropriate services for them. Do you have an idea?
Well, the data is unfortunately very, very distressing
right.
because it shows that something like half of the people who are homeless have substance abuse or mental disorders.
Right.
Moreover, many times, at least for African Americans, we have the additional problem that many of these individuals have spent at least some of the time in the correctional system. And what that means is they often cannot immediately get the services they need. So there's been, again, a great effort to make sure that people in the correctional system get mental health or substance abuse services, but we find that two-thirds of them cannot access these services once they leave the correctional system because of the rules about lack of access due to Medicaid rules, because some of them cannot have access due to the loss of the citizenship as part of having a felony conviction,
right.
And they often cannot get jobs because right. of background checks showing that they've many times may not have been involved in any kind of violent confrontation, but may have, because of their mental disorder, failed to keep up with the probation officer
right.
Because they just can't get it together.
Right. I also would like to not be remiss by saying, once an individual, be it a vet or any other person, starts to present signs of mental illness, that it doesn't just affect the individual, it impacts the whole family. And they are not just sick in a vacuum, so we have to look at how well the family is able to process and support what is going on with them as well.
Absolutely. Part of it is economic. The cost of taking care of a mentally ill individual, the direct costs, many times exceed the median income of African American families.
Right.
Moreover, we're now recognizing that most mental disorders begin before the age of 14. And also need to recognize, especially when it affects the mother,
yes.
that it has a tremendous effect in terms of the child and child rearing.
Yes.
So early recognition, early intervention is necessary. What we often find is that the children of mothers who are mentally ill, not because the mothers are deliberately trying to harm the child, but just because they simply, because of their illness, are
yes.
unable to invest in the child.
Right.
The child starts out behind in terms of cognitive functioning, in terms of even their physical health later,
right.
and in terms of being able to get a job, function in school, and et cetera.
I just want to say this. You briefly mentioned the treatment approach, and I do know how important psychopharmacology is and how important it is for patients who have psychiatric disorders to stick with your medical regimes. What kind of information would you leave with individuals in treatment or family members who are concerned about individuals in treatment as we close?
I got my feet set in both camps. On one hand, I've done a lot of research and work with psychopharmacology, and I recognize that we've made tremendous advances, introduced new treatments that literally have changed the lives of individuals.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, I am also very concerned about the misuse of psychopharmacology, the fact that we tend to overuse it,
yeah.
and that really one of the big benefits of psychopharmacology is that it actually helps people to benefit more from psychotherapy.
Oh, okay.
Often, we have psychotherapy that works now.
Yes.
That's been tried and working in the African-American community.
Uh-huh.
But the cost of delivering psychotherapy, the lack of resources, means many times that people only get pharmacotherapy, and often late, when early interventions with various kinds of psychotherapeutic interventions could may even prevent the need for pharmacotherapy later.
Yes, it's the combination of the psychotherapy and the medication. The medication puts the client where the psychotherapy can work. And for us, that many times is out of reach. Let's talk about some resources. I know that Howard University has wonderful clinics. Are there other community-based clinics or resources? I was presented with a special problem by one of my church members one Sunday as we were going out. And she said to me, "I know you are a nurse, and I'm concerned about my grandson. He really is doing some strange things, and I know that I need to get him in to see somebody, but I can't afford it, and I don't know where to take him."
Mm-hmm.
I was really wasted because I didn't know exactly how to direct her other than saying, go to the website for the Department of Mental Health. Could you offer up some more specific suggestions other than that?
Well, I think that is a good one. The Department of Mental Health has set up a series of what you call core service agencies. These are privately owned but supported agencies around the city.
Okay.
And that meet a criterion for having a special realm of clinical services.
Right.
In addition to the Department of Mental Health, as you mentioned, it's Howard University. We have a full range of services as well. We now have contracted through several agencies to provide mental health services through Medicaid. The district is blessed in being able to have a healthcare payment system that allows most people to qualify for some sort of Medicaid treatment, even if they are low income.
Oh, that's good
to
know.
So we have the good services. The problem many times is that we may not be able to access the providers. There's a disconnect between the number of providers and the number of people that need services. So you may end up being put on a waiting list. That is a reality. We try to discourage the use of having folks having to go to the emergency room, but sometimes it's necessary. The good news is that emergency rooms know how to contact key individuals. The good news also is that not only do we have a number of private core service agencies, but we also have a number of private providers that can be reached. The Washington Psychiatric Society is more than happy to link people up, as well as other organizations. If you want primary African-American members, you can contact the Association of Black Psychologists or the Black Psychiatrists of America.
Okay.
I recently became the president of the DC Mental Health America, and we're working to be able to link people up better with services in the district.
Well, I thank you. And if I could leave anybody with one word, I would say that mental health problems are treatable, and individuals living with mental health problems can live very productive lives, as Dr. Lawson has said, if they are in adequate treatment. Health Matters is a television series to assist you in managing your health care. If you would like more information about the topic of this program or of the University of the District of Columbia's Department of Nursing and Health Professions, please visit our website at www.udc.edu. I'm Dr. Connie Webster, thanking you for watching, and remember, your health matters.